And we are live. Welcome to William Tell TV in the afternoon. Today I'm joined with my, today for our afternoon show. Hopefully we'll be doing this, hopefully every afternoon, or as many afternoons as we can fit in. That's for sure. But I'm joined by our special guest. You know him. He's a friend of the show. Mr. Sean Brown, how you doing this afternoon, Mr. Sean Brown?
Hello, everybody out there. I'm doing well, CG. How you doing today?
I'm not doing too bad. It's a little rainy here where I live. It's pouring, in fact.
We've just got some clouds and maybe some rain and a threat of it for the next 5 days.
Yeah, it's supposed to rain here a lot as well.
Well, isn't that supposed to happen in the springtime, though? Because I don't know about you, I'm pretty tired of this winter.
I'm ready for the winter to be over with, that's for damn sure. I'm grabbing an energy drink out of my refrigerator. But no, I'm ready for winter to be over. But welcome to our little show in the afternoon. We're going to try to slowly come up with a name for it. Right now, it's kind of just generally talking nerdy. Talking politics, talking sports. Today, we've got some interesting political topics to bring to the forefront. And, of course, today's also... Here at 4 p.m. Eastern this afternoon will be the start of free agency for football.
I'll be watching Twitter to see if anything breaks along the way. And well, not even just in that. If any breaking news comes about during our chats, I'll make sure to bring them up.
Many of our other channels are a little more gamer-centric, but we like to show that here at William Tell TV, we're more than just gamers. Some of us are super
sexy. And our aim is not to do it just because, you know, we're like that. We realize that all gamers are like that. We don't like to think that just because you like to game that you have this label that's all you do, because we know you're not. You're more than that. You're just like us. Because that's something that's always kind of bothered me, how we just kind of blatantly just label people as one thing and say, oh, that's all you are. Well, we know you're not. I mean that in a good way, not like, no, you are nothing. You are everything.
I want to start out today, Sean Brown. I want to start out today talking because it's near and dear to my heart. And we haven't, and you know, me and Mr. Brown, we've been friends for years, went to college together, and we talk a lot of shop, talk a lot of football, a lot of things. But you know, we haven't talked recently, Sean Brown. I haven't talked to you in depth, Denver Broncos, free agents. Last season we let walk Eric Decker. He was the primary big person we kind of let walk. And, of course, Doomerville, I guess also, the Doomerville snafu. I guess that was 2 seasons ago. But I don't know how I feel about Julius Thomas. Because I read an interesting little piece over on ESPN.com. And they were talking about how between him and Orlando Franklin, not only are they signing elsewhere, but we have not even discussed a contract with them, period. Or I say we, I shouldn't say we. The Broncos have not discussed a contract with them, period. Did you realize that? That even with Julius Thomas... Broncos never even initiated even an initial conversation about maybe doing a contract at any point.
That's very strange to me. Especially knowing what I know about, you know, how John Elway likes to run his team. It baffles me. It really does.
I mean, it's interesting. And he's not bad, but he's not Julius Thomas. Is Virgil Green, one of the Denver Broncos' backup tight ends. He came in for a lot of blocking situations. They kind of made a big deal about it because he finally got a touchdown late in the season. And
well, it's funny you bring him up because I was reading that it's going to come down to him. I'm sorry, to the Broncos or the Bears for his services.
Who, Julius Thomas?
No, Virgil Green.
Virgil Green, yeah, that's who apparently we want to focus on getting. Which, you know, he's definitely a decent back. My dad. He's definitely a decent tight end, but I don't know. He's not as good as Julius Thomas. The only thing I can think of they see is last year when Julius Thomas came back from his injury, he never really had the kind of impact that we needed. And, you know, it was one of those things where had Julius Thomas been able to have any of those kind of monster games after that injury, it could have helped us a lot, especially in the playoffs. But at the same time, you know, we had a lot of injuries on the Broncos. A lot of players were playing through injuries. So to me, it's, you know, we give some players a break for playing through injury. And I'm sure Julius Thomas was playing through injuries as well.
See, I almost feel like with what's his name going to looks like he's going to sign with Jacksonville, that it's almost imperative that you guys resign him.
Oh, I stepped on my Oriental one. you know, it, like I said, I guess we are tight on some money. He can't build through free agency, but, you know, he was a homegrown product. You know, you always teams always preach, you know, you got to build from within. You don't sign free agents to build a team.
No, he's one of those.
Him and Franklin really are homegrown products. Because really, successful teams don't have many busy free agency periods as the Broncos did last season. Because you can't do that and be a contender. You need depth in that. You get depth through the draft. But it's just a shame to see him go. But, you know, we still have a lot of other pieces. Interestingly, I read an article on ESPN as well that they linked Andre Johnson to the Broncos, which I don't really see the point. You know, I feel like we already have one of those in Demaryius Thomas.
True, but it's nice when you can have, you know, wide receivers that are the size of basketball power.
Here's a question for you. If you have an option, because they're both out there, Reggie Wayne, Andre Johnson, if you're going to bring in a one-year contract, aging previous premier top wide receiver, do you not go with... Even if maybe you say Andre Johnson at this point in their careers has a little edge over Reggie Wayne, could one not say, does the connection with Peyton Manning play a factor? You know, because Peyton Manning once said that him and Reggie Wayne used to throw footballs in the dark. Another one of them Chris Collinsworth tales.
I'm glad you brought that up because he... Still to this day, they use that track line on Madden.
So You know, like, so, you know, so they had that kind of connection. So, you know, for me, I just wonder with that kind of connection, if you're gonna go with the Broncos, and I'm not against it because, you know, you have Emmanuel Sanders, you have Demaryius Thomas, you know, you're gonna, but without Julius Thomas, you're gonna need a big three. We got this dude, Cody Latimer, that there really is a lot of buzz about him. He didn't get a lot of playing time last year, but we were really deep in wide receiver, and they kind of intentionally let it. He had, I think, 13 receptions the whole season, but he wasn't used much. But there's a lot of pomp and circumstance about him. He's really predicted to be really, really good, hopefully. So this season will be his play out. So presumably, you know, between Demaryius Thomas, him, and Emmanuel Sanders, we have three there. We need O-line help. With Orlando Franklin gone, the Broncos need three linemen, and we need the Broncos need a tight end now. But you know, for him, if you're going to add one of those, I'm not against it. It's a younger wide receiving core. You know, with Emmanuel Sanders probably being the oldest and him not that old, you know, it would bring a little in with presumably Wes Welker not returning. I'm sure he's going to sign elsewhere. You know, it's when he's not even being talked about being re-signed with the Broncos. So with him leaving, you know, I'm not against bringing in a 1 year cheap contract veteran wide receiver, and I think a Andre Johnson would be great. I just think maybe if you're going to connect Andre Johnson there, if I'm John Elway, you know, or especially if I'm Peyton Manning, if we're going to bring in an old veteran guy, let's bring in somebody that you know, yeah, he's going to have to learn the system just like Andre Johnson will. But I guess also that's probably the connection is Andre Johnson already knows Kubiak's system, so it's so there's really a connection there. It's one of those things, and for me, you know, I don't know. Andre Johnson knows the system, but Reggie Wayne already has that connection with Peyton Manning.
See, that's where I wanted to drive at is I've always liked Kubiak's system from the time that he's been in Houston all the way
Well,
to
how
his
long did we say when he
recent
was down in
time in
Houston
Baltimore.
he needed a quarterback when he had
Yes.
Schaub? We were like, he has an awesome team. If he had a quarterback, and Schaub wasn't bad, but.
How much latitude are they going to give to Peyton? Is it going to be now he has to run the confines
Well,
of Kubiak's system, or is he going to have a lot of the open, I'm going to call my plays under the Gase system?
I don't know. I think, well, one would argue that's more of the Manning system,
That very, very true.
because Gase won't be running that, and it doesn't or doesn't run that, or you know, in our previous offensive coordinators didn't go. What's his name? Who went over to San Diego? You know, he ran that same system with Peyton
Mike
before
McCoy.
Gase, McCoy, and he doesn't use that Peyton system. That's more of a Peyton system than a coach system. But I think it's going to be interesting because Peyton Manning has never played in a system like Kubiak's, and Kubiak is very much a quarterback independent system where you can plug in. That's why he was successful in Baltimore. That's what got him back on the right track this season. That's what was successful in Houston, is they didn't have a quarterback, but they could make it do with a solid running game, good possession receivers, and really dominant defensive play. So I don't know, because I've heard, you know, I've read interviews with Elway and Kubiak, and they say, you know, it's, you know, Elway's like, you know, they're going to do what they're going to do. I think they're going to work well together. Kubiak's like, you know, we're going to use my system, but, you know, there's things that Peyton's does well that we're going to use as well. And then Peyton's like, you know, I can learn any system. So, you know, I really don't know. You know, to me, for Peyton Manning to win a couple of rings, this is how I think it would have to see it play out, and this is why I think Elway wanted Kubiak to help sell Peyton Manning on this, of saying, Peyton Manning, the team that we will field for the next 2, 3 years, the last 2, 3 years of your career, or year or two, is not going to look like any team you have ever played on before. I think if they want to give Peyton another ring on the Broncos, which even with our departures, we're still one of the top teams in the league. We still have a dominant receiving core. We have one of the top three defenses in the league. We have phenomenal secondaries, great pressure. You know, we have good running backs. There's a good blocking tight ends. Julius Thomas is a receiving tight end, but we still have really great blocking tight ends. We have a lot, and I think what John Elway's, when Elway won his rings finally in Denver, it's when they had a system in place where they ran the hell out of the ball with Terrell Davis. They had Rod Stewart on the outside running deep for the ball, which is your Demaryius Thomas. You've got your C.J. Anderson and company in the backfield to be your Terrell Davis. And then this is the shame with seeing Julius Thomas go. He had his Shannon Sharpe as his security blanket. Now, I think Emmanuel Sanders could potentially be that security blanket, which is why I think Kubiak looks at Andre Johnson, because Andre Johnson wouldn't play the same position he played in Houston with Denver, because Demaryius Thomas plays that for us. And at this point, he is better. But, you know, so I could really see...
She's 14.
Oh, good.
Look how fat she is.
I could really see, I think, to win, if the Broncos come out and it just looks, because, you know, really, since Peyton Manning came to the Broncos, it was Peyton Manning's team. You know, it was his offense. It looked no different than it did in Indianapolis. It worked better because we had better talent around him than he had in Indianapolis, but it looked the same. It still ran the same.
Right.
But I think what Elway saw at the end of last season.
Oh, good. And you know was where Kim and their family go often?
The resort.
That's where they are right now.
Elway, I think, saw at the end of last season, he saw the Broncos win with Peyton Manning under center in the last four or five games of the season, and even in the playoffs. The Broncos, in the playoffs less so, but particularly into the season, Broncos won five games at the end of the season with Peyton Manning not playing well. But we still looked dominant.
And hurt.
And we still looked dominant. Because our running game, we were averaging over 100 yards a game. Our defense was suffocating. Our wide receivers were making big timely plays when they needed to. You saw the Broncos with Peyton Manning look different and be successful, and that, I think, is why Elway said, let's make a change. And because he saw Kubiak out there going, what if we sold out on that idea? What if we sold out on we are a running team that plays defense, and that will be the heart and soul of what the Denver Broncos are. We will pretend we do not have Peyton Manning. That's why I think the Broncos acted like they would have been so okay if he chose to retire. Because for them, I think they are going to sell out towards, we're going to be a run-first team that plays suffocating defense. The difference is, unlike before when Kubiak ran it, instead of Schaub, we have Manning. So those games when our running game can't get it going, we have Manning.
Breaking hot off the press, Virgil Green will remain with the Broncos, multi-year deal, $3 million per annum.
Not bad. letting Julius Thomas go, we had to bring him back. In fact, right. I honestly think he's the reason we let Julius Thomas go, because in Kubiak's system, he needs a tight end to get some passes. But running, Virgil Green is a better blocking tight end than, in fact, he's our premier blocking tight end, which we need for our running game. So that kind of doesn't surprise me. But, you know, so I do think, you know, it's nothing against Peyton Manning's style of football, and he is phenomenal. But I really think, you know, the year he won his only ring that year.
Don't remind me.
The Colts had a phenomenal running game. And that playoffs, that postseason, not that season, if I remember clearly, but that playoffs, their defense played out of their minds. They won their ring with suffocating defense and an unstoppable running game.
Well, to be fair, if it would have been a lot closer game if Rex Grossman wasn't
Rex Grossman,
the quarterback of my Chicago Bears.
The entire shoreline is made out of dock. You see that?
How I don't think we would have. I still don't think we would have won that game. It would have been a lot closer than 29-17. It might have been 29-24 or something like that, but we still would have lost.
Isn't that cute, though?
I mean, so, although it is interesting, you know, it amazes me, you know, something I pay attention to as I'm older with free agency and stuff. It amazes me how much people like to work together. Like Orlando Franklin, we have a new blocking scheme in Denver. We don't even talk to Orlando Franklin. Oh, my. And he goes over to where? Mike McCoy, whom he played with before. In fact, who I believe was the offensive coordinator when he was drafted. You know, you look in Chicago picking up some of Denver's free agents. I am surprised that some of our bigger free agents have not landed in Chicago. Because y'all could have absolutely used a Julius Thomas, could have absolutely used an Orlando Franklin. Y'all, honestly, I would not be surprised. What is the status of Wes Welker? Has he been connected with any teams?
You know, I haven't been looking for anything on him.
Because he's somebody for the Bears.
I haven't even seen his name come up.
I haven't either. And he's somebody where if he has anything left in the tank, he might not be a bad option for a team like the Bears that needs a reliable receiver that maybe isn't going to give much, but you'd get him cheap. And he'd be able to bring a little veteran leadership.
We need something in the slot right now.
And he would go...
And, I mean, he's sure-handed still, even after 27 concussions and all that.
So, I think he would be somewhere, up in, he wouldn't be a primary thing, but I think, if anything, for the Bears, give him a little veteran leadership, somebody who knows what it takes to win a championship on the team.
I tell you what, I don't know if you saw this. Jake Long got released by the Rams. I don't know how much he's got left in his tank, but it would be very interesting to see if the Bears were to be able to pick him up to put him on the line as well with his brother. How that might help them out.
I think it's Tim, though. It looks like Tim.
But there has been a couple of surprises. You know, what's happened in San Francisco is amazing.
Oh my goodness, yes. I mean, they are just falling left and right now out of there.
And I used to tell people back, remember when during the 2016 years of the Lions, I used to tell people, until you get Matt Millen out of there, the team's not going to get better. I said, because the problem is bigger than a GM or coach. It's who's hiring the GM and coach. Because the person hiring the GM and coach is not capable of doing it. They can't bring in the right personnel. This is the issue with a Jerry Jones, or specifically a Dan Snyder, where he wants to call all the shots, but he has no ability to decide whether a good coach or a good GM are good fits for the team and good fits for each other. And they got rid of Matt Millen, and even with Jim Schwartz, who was there for the 0-16 season, Jim Schwartz also took them to the playoffs. And mainly what they changed is the leadership above them. And they brought in a new GM. That new president brought in a new GM. I think that's the problem you see with the 49ers is it really does seem, as much was made out of it, it was simply the owners didn't like Jim Harbaugh.
Well, it's very interesting because in that dynamic, the 49ers dynamic, I'm seeing a lot of parallels to what's going on with my favorite basketball team, Chicago Bulls. The Bulls have a fantastic coach in Tom Thibodeau. But he's wearing out his welcome because he runs the hardest practices the world has ever seen. I'm okay with that. Don't get me wrong. I want my team to be tenacious on defense, and I want them to have the best chance of winning. Now, if he gets pushed out of the door, like a lot of people think is going to happen, a la what happened in San Francisco, who else can you get? It's, you know, a lot of these, it's very strange that, you know, like in, also with the case of Brandon Marshall, can what you actually give and provide to the team, even though you might be a little bit of a distraction, is it worth it? In Thibodeau's case, I think it is, because I don't know who else could get the most out of the way the Bulls are set up right now.
Well, and I think it's a better – you hit to the most salient point is what do you get? And I think that is the issue that 49ers is. You have a proven winning coach in the NFL and in college. He's proven winning. His players enjoy him. And, you know, you have that situation and you make a decision that's ultimately – those look like boobies – ultimately – it's going to be bad for the team. And to me, it's like even if he rubs you the wrong way, it's like your job as owners is to win championships. He is the best option. And just like with the Bulls, who else are you going to get? Now they have someone that's untested at the position. And now they didn't foresee this happening, but now they've lost four key pivotal people. They've lost Gore, Crabtree, Willis, and what's his name? Now, he's – what's his name is actually retiring because he's like 35, 34, 38, something like that. But
34.
But, you know, that's four big pivotal parts of your team that have been big pivotal parts that you're suddenly gone with. And really the only flaw that Harbaugh had was Kaepernick, because Kaepernick isn't the answer. He was better than what they had. But Kaepernick, arguably.
Well,
but,
was he? Well,
and that's something else is.
Have Alex Smith.
Well, I think the problem is with Alex Smith, you would have always been allowed to replace him. Once you get rid of Alex Smith in place for Kaepernick, you've now tied your you've hitched your wagon to the Kaepernick train.
Okay, wait. Do you see this? You see this right here? This is a mama cat that hasn't had babies yet.
And, I mean, you know, look, if I'm a 49ers fan and I'm looking at the past, I mean, ultimately going to Kaepernick proved to be the right decision. There has to be something else going on in that organization that obviously is not going to be aired. Because I've never heard of Tom Sula. Never. And I don't know if you listened to his presser at all. I tell you something. It was one of the least inspiring things I've heard from a sports coach in a long, long time.
Well, that's what I want to know what their game is, because you get somebody unproven. You know, it'd have been one thing if, you know, they'd gone, you know, but Jim Harbaugh was really successful. He took you to your first Super Bowl in 20 years. More than 20. And it's just, I mean, that's just a mess. And it's one of those things where it shows you in football how ownership can really mess up. Because when you look at the franchises with continued success over the generations in football, the Steelers, the Packers, the Patriots. You know, the Patriots are a perfect example of, they are a franchise that is other than cheating, they've been for 15 years,
Lost.
From the top down, they've had consistency, and they've had good people from the top down, and that has led through success. Their owner has done the most important job, is he keeps his coach and quarterback together and lets them do their thing from there. And sell it as a team idea. You know, it's funny, you know, people talk about, oh, it's a big deal for, you know, Peyton Manning to take a pay cut, whatever, you know, there shouldn't be any loyalty, whatever. And I'm like, yeah, but at the same time, like, and this is what I think is, if I'm building the team and this is what I think Patriots put above all else, and I think more so than most other teams, is the team first, win first mentality of, we're not here to make a lot of money. We're here to win championships. If we win championships, we will get a lot of money. But we're here to win championships because to me, like, it amazes me. You're Julius Thomas. What reasoning do you have to go to the Jacksonville Jaguars? Now, I guess, thank God, there are players that are willing to take money. But to me, I guess it's surprising how – I mean, I know you might want to – maybe you do want to win a championship with a specific team, and that can be your motivation. But, you know, it just surprises me – you know, I remember when people talk about all the different teams that Peyton Manning could potentially land, and the only one I was ever worried about was the 49ers. And I was like, why would Peyton Manning want to go to a bad team? He's going to go – if he gets to pick his team, he's going to pick the best team that gives him the best chance to win a championship. And I don't know. It's just – it surprises me how often players choose the money over championships, because if you win championships, the money comes.
Well, I think in this case, and even with the case of Ndamukong Suh, no income tax in Florida makes all the money that gets thrown at you even more worth even more.
And that's a move I want to talk about. What do you think about that move?
Well,
putting him on the line with Cameron Wake?
You know, the only thing that hurts them is how massive that contract is, because I hope they have enough around them, because they're going to be strapped for cash for years.
Well, you know, I think definitely so. But I think he is one of those players.
He's worth every penny. Don't get me wrong.
My point is I think it's one of those things where, like, when you say, do they have other things around him? No. But I think the reason he's worth that kind of money is he is like a Peyton Manning, a J.J. Watt, a Tom Brady, where players play better.
I honestly believe he is the closest to a Reggie White that we've seen in 20 years.
Yeah. Hey, I mean, although him and J.J. Watt are those two guys are two of the best defensive players I've ever seen from any era. I mean, they're both just beasts. And, you know, and Ndamukong Suh, I think, for the Dolphins are, you know, for that defense, Dolphins' biggest weakness on defense, run defense. Ndamukong Suh, that problem goes away.
Solved, exactly.
Cameron Wake, really good numbers. He's been the dude on that line drawing double and triple teams. Now Suh is on the line. He will draw the double and triple teams. And what? I have a question. Do you want to go 1v1 with Cameron Wake?
I'd rather go over him than Suh.
Well, yeah, but I'm just saying, I don't envy the guy that has to go 1v1 with Cameron Wake. When he doesn't often get that opportunity. And Cameron Wake frees him up, puts some more pressure on the quarterback. Same thing for all the linemen. I think it's one of those things. Suh is a player that he fills more holes than simply the hole that he can physically fill. You think of all the Patriots defenses that were covered up for how atrocious they were, and then we would learn in the playoffs that their secondary was abysmal, and who covered all that up? Vince Wilfork.
Yep.
And as good as Wilfork is, and or was, he's no Suh. So that's why I'm okay with it. I know it will strap them for cash. I think it will limit some of the moves that they can make. But I think when you're a team that's dumping a bunch of money and renovating your stadium, you're trying to put butts in seats, you're trying to compete with the Patriots and the Jets and the Bills who are making moves. And last year, and I'm going to tell you what, Miami the past, what, 2-3 seasons have been 7-9, 8-8. I have a question. With Suh, with Miami from last year, when 8-8, does Suh put them at 10-6?
he himself might be worth two games.
So I agree. I think he's worth 1 to 2 wins. So
it as long as he behaves and you know, doesn't kick people in the crotch and shit like that.
But he's worth 1 to 2 wins. So he puts at Miami from 8-8 to 9-7, 10-6 last season in the AFC. That puts them in the playoffs.
I mean, the one thing that's jumping out in my head right now is the game at Lane Stadium when Virginia Tech came back to beat Nebraska. And I still see it in my head when Tyrod is running around to his right. You know who almost sacked him twice on that play? So.
So, to me, that's the difference. Is Miami is a team that's been at 500 for multiple seasons now.
I tell you what.
And I think he is enough to push them over that edge.
I don't think Ryan Tannehill is a slouch. I think that he's continually growing as a quarterback. And, you know, I'll venture out on a limb and I'll say that that whole AFC East now is going to be a very tough division, because after seeing Sua twice a year for, 4 years in the NFC North, I'm happy to see him gone. Let me tell you what.
Well, and now you're Peyton, now you're Tom Brady, and you got to face twice a year Mario Williams, and then twice a year Ndamukong Suh. I don't envy Brady.
I mean, they have a lot of interesting storylines coming around, too. Brandon Browner is probably going to be a free agent because they're not going to give him a raise. They didn't pick up the option on Wilfork. They didn't pick up the option on Revis. So now Revis has all the leverage in the world to start a bidding war between them and the Jets. So,
do you think there could be any surprise teams coming in to grab Revis?
Well, there's a lot of teams out there that have some cash, but I think it's just going to come down to those two. I don't think he really wants to play anywhere else.
It's interesting how those are the two teams that he decides between.
Well, Todd Bowles is now the coach in New York, correct?
Yes.
He's got a pretty good relationship with
Did
him.
Did Rex land anywhere? Yeah, he's Rex the coach of the Buffalo. Bills. That's right. Passed over the Falcon job. I still think he made a mistake there.
Yeah, there's more pieces there, and well, you know, I think part of it for Rex going to Buffalo is
I think he still wants to compete with the Patriots.
That, absolutely, and I think he also wants to stick it to the Jets a little bit, too.
Yeah, now he has a personal vendetta against all of them.
And, hell, Rex makes for good TV, man.
Rex will make them more relevant. And I think for him, now, I think that if I'm answering the question, do I think it's a good... Orton. Yeah, do I... Like, if you ask me, do I think it's a good decision for the Bills? I mean, for Rex Ryan. No, I think he would have been better off in Atlanta. Now... You ask me if I'm the Buffalo Bills, is he a good hire? Abso-goddamn-lutely. Because he's immediately going to make you more relevant himself. And he's a team guy. He's going to be loyal. He's going to be all about the Bills. He's going to be out there touting you on TV. He's going to be out there doing all of these things. He's worth every damn penny. He really is.
I mean, especially for a relatively proud franchise that has, you know, that needs a good shot in the arm, it would have been silly if they didn't take the investment.
Yeah, he's...
I don't claim to pretend that I'm a Bills fan or, you know, I don't have any rooting interest, but I know that when all the teams that are in New York, just like all the teams in California, going even through baseball, when all your Chicago teams, everything, it's good for the league.
Yeah. And that's something that, like, people may and do hate the Yankees. But when the Yankees are good, it's good for the league. Which may honestly be one of the reasons that people may give them, maybe one of the reasons people so rabidly hate them is even more so for that reason. Or like when the Dallas Cowboys are good, it is good for the league. When the Lakers are good, it is good for the league. It's unfortunate, but when these big franchises are good, it is good for the league. And especially, you know, it's something to be said for, you know, the AFC West for 3-4 seasons were just dominated by the Chargers. They had gotten really good while everybody was slacking back. And now, gradually, the Chiefs are a pretty decent team. The Broncos are the powerhouse of the division. The Chargers are still good. The Raiders are actually getting better, surprisingly, like actually making legitimate strides to improve. And, you know, all of these things happen, and it just shows you that when a team in a division gets strong, it's good for the whole division. And I think, interestingly, I think when Rex Ryan came to the Jets, he challenged the Patriots. And since that happened, the whole division has gotten better. And strong divisions, you know, like it's funny. I was reading some comments on a thread, on a forum, and they were talking about wins and divisions and things, and they pointed out, you know, something. They were like, you know, why did he always struggle in the playoffs? Why do the Colts now struggle in the playoffs? Why do a lot of Colt fans and people talk about the Colts still are building, and yet they're last year they were in the talk for Super Bowl? And it's like, because they play in such a perennial weak division, the Colts do, and have for like 15 years. The Colts get a free pass into the playoffs every year, regardless of how good they are. And some seasons they can go into the playoffs because they're not bad, but they're not up there with the Patriots. I mean, they beat a really broken Broncos team, a really injured top from the top down team. Then they go play a healthy actual titan of the conference and the Patriots, and they get smacked in the mouth with a flat football. But the Colts, they look like they're better than they are because they're always in the playoffs. And any NFL team, you give me one game to play somebody, I might be able to win. So they get a free pass into the playoffs, and that gives the appearances of that they're better than they are, even though the Colts are still rebuilding. I mean, really, the Colts don't have much. Frank Gore is a great pickup for the Colts.
Yeah, but he's got a lot of wear on the tires. I mean, does he improve them? Yes, but you're right.
I want us to research something.
Okay.
And I want to talk about it. Friday's the next day I have off. Friday's the next day I have off. So we'll do it Friday afternoon because tomorrow and Thursday I work. But it is going to require a little research because I read it and I'm intrigued, because if so, we need to write about it and get it out there because it's asinine. There is something along the lines of, I read on a comment, and I just want to determine the veracity, and if it's true, really maybe write something, put up on the website, maybe even submit to some places, because it'd be really interesting, and I've not at least looked into it to see if there's anything out there. But somebody mentioned something. There's something weird going on with Trent Richardson with the Colts, in that they are, even though he's completely healthy, they are keeping him on the deactive list, because something about, like, they don't want to play him and they don't want to pay him, or there's something going on where they're doing that because they don't want him anymore, but they don't want to have to release him or pay him as much money, and so they're intentionally keeping him on the deactivated list, even though he apparently wants a release. And they're preventing that from happening by doing that, and also not letting him play or compete or participate in things because of the list that he's on.
That's egregious if that's true.
So, like I said, I don't know the veracity of that. I don't have the full knowledge. But that's just, like you said, egregious if true. So that's just a little assignment for me and you. Do some research over the next 2 days. And then Friday afternoon, we'll do the next afternoon cast. We'll see what our research entails, or our reveals, whether it's nothing and it's just a hoax. Is there something to it? Because, you know, for me, if it is what it is on its face, it's egregious to be intentionally, essentially blackballing a player out of the league entirely and limiting the money and things he's allowed to get because of the list you're keeping him on, to save his roster spot for someone else, but to also make sure he's not getting what he's due. That would really be egregious. But now we've talked football. It's free agency. We're here. We're 30 minutes away. Chances are things are going to pick up violently.
Well, speaking of that, Terrence Knighton, it looks like the Raiders are the front runners. The Colts are still in the mix, but the Bears and the Redskins are out on his services.
Okay.
Disappointing for me.
He would have been good for you guys. It's a shame we're losing him. Just another one of our free agents going. But he was mainly here because of Jack Del Rio. So that's why he will probably end up in Oakland, because he came here from Jacksonville because he's traveling with Del Rio. Because Del Rio drafted him.
And they have about $66 million in cap space right now, which is ridiculous.
I'm surprised they haven't made bigger moves. They could use a Julius Thomas. There's a lot they could use. But anyway, but we're going to switch to politics for 30 minutes. Keep us updated, though, Sean Brown, with any free agent wire reports. I need to give you, in situations like this, what I should give you is I need to give you the login information for William Tell Gaming's Twitter, so you can tweet. No, it's gaming. Well, it's exclusively gaming. Anyway, so we'll talk politics, because at 4, it's going to be crazy talking about NFL to wrap up the show. So we're going to start talking about something, and I'm a big fan, I know, as you are. I'm sure our viewers are as well. While we're switching segments, thank you for tuning in. We're talking football, we're talking politics, we're talking some tech sometimes. This is just talking nerdy. I'm a big fan of Last Week Tonight with John Oliver. Big fan of his show. Loved him on The Daily Show. Love his new show. His new show's Last Week Tonight. It airs on HBO on Sunday nights, I think 10 p.m. I don't have HBO, so I follow his YouTube channel at YouTube at Last Week Tonight, and love his segments. And he did an interesting segment, and it's a topic that I've discussed with you and other people sometimes. Is we have five U.S. territories. Can you name the five U.S. territories?
I will do my best. Puerto Rico, Guam, the United States, Virgin Islands, American Samoa, and number five is slipping my head.
Shit, now that you say that, it's slipping mine. And I just had it. Like, when I asked that question, I had them in my mind. American Samoa, Guam, U.S. Virgin Islands, Puerto Rico. That bothers me. I can't remember. It's a shame.
Did I say Guam already? Yeah, I think I did.
We'll have to look that up. I'm not at my computer right now, even though I'm casting. But there's five of them. Yeah, there you go. There's five of them, and none of them can vote. And John Oliver pointed me to a court case to investigate.
And the Northern Marianas Islands, and if you really want to get technical as well, District of Columbia.
So, it was a court case, Supreme Court case from 1901, and in this case it discusses why these territories don't get to vote. They're U.S. citizens, but they don't get to vote. Is because they're foreign, they're alien races. And they can't mesh with Anglo-Saxon society. You know, overall it intrigues me. Is it a matter? I've always kind of been led to believe that one of the things blocking it is, like Puerto Rico, for example, they don't want to be a state.
Correct. I mean, technically the United States, even though it is our territory, they run themselves.
We have had recently, just a couple of years ago, it was on all over the news and media because there was a bill in the House to make Puerto Rico a state, which would lead me to believe, if the House could propose such a bill, would lead me to believe that what is potentially holding up the process is the United States government. So that's something I need to get more clear on. What is preventing them from becoming a state? Is it truly their desire to not be states? But one would argue it's not, though, because when you I don't know if you've watched John Oliver's piece yet, but when you see these soldiers and you see statistics like in Guam, a quarter of their land is used for our military base. And an eighth of its population serves in the military, which is the highest percentage of any state. When you hear these people say they love America and they want to serve their country and things, these are people that consider themselves American citizens, that speak good English, that know, you know, that are... that seem on its face, at least, like they really would like to be American citizens. In fact, not only would they desire to be, they are American citizens. They just don't get the right to vote because they're not states. And
see,
I wonder, and
that with in the example for the people of Guam, where it's, you know, a quarter of their land is to the military, eighth of their people have served, that the VA gives them the least amount of money. And
did you notice who was second to last?
Yeah, Virginia.
Virginia. At a whopping $400 more.
Which that in itself is alarming.
I know, I was surprised at the low numbers. Like, I know it said, like Guam was, like, 847, but, like, Virginia was, like, 1225. Like, either way, both of those numbers seem low.
Well, it speaks to a larger problem. The veterans, no matter if they're from a full United States state, a territory, protectorate, or whatever, we're not taking care of the people who take care of us as a country.
Well, I think the reason that we're having a hard movement on that is I think the whole, and I say this, as you know, with the most utmost respect for our military, I feel like people are getting fatigued on the we love our veteran things, and it's because it's a war that, yeah, they convinced us we all wanted when it happened, and we wanted to go to war with Afghanistan, but we're fatigued by war. Where now, by and large, people are pretty much think we just shouldn't be over there anymore. We're done. We don't want to be over there anymore as a nation. And I think it's a sense of it's kind of laxed because we're having all these veterans coming home with all these, you know, these issues and things, and it's like, you know, we're having a hard enough time putting ourselves to work, fixing our problems here. And one of the big reasons why is because we've been at war. And, you know, it's funny. It used to be war made a lot of money. You know, wars would bring countries out of... I mean, World War II brought the entire world out of the Great Depression.
Yes, it did.
It did a lot of damage. It killed a lot of people. But the one thing it did do is... that was, you know, I mean, arguably decent, but definitely not worth the cost. But it did pull the world out of a Great Depression. You know, World War I pulled the world out of an economic downturn. You know, it granted that was coinciding also with the Industrial Revolution, which has probably had more to, but now with how war is fought, there's not as much money in it. And the whole idea of perpetual war, we're pretty much over and done with. I mean, even with now Iran's willingness to try to kind of end this stalemate, except for a few areas in the world. Now, I mean, I realize there's a lot of problems in the world. But as far as global threats, there aren't many left. You know, like, Russia is going off all half-cocked with Ukraine and stuff, but Russia's not looking for a world war. No country is looking for a world war anymore. Wars aren't going to be fought on the same massive scale, and part of the big reason is we don't want that to happen anymore. Things like that happened when we let you just draft a couple of million of us. We don't let you just draft us to the military anymore.
Alright, this has never happened before.
What?
No, I mean, the only really big threat that I see right now is ISIS. You know?
Why do you think? But what makes them a truly global threat?
They are operating on a different playing field than we've ever seen before. They don't really have a home except for all the places that they are taking it. And it's for me, it's something where I don't want to get involved. As a country, I don't want to get involved. But what they're doing to the rest of the world, is horrible. It's absolutely horrible.
I cut back the feed, so.
I'm not going to play WoW.
Although it was laggy.
I don't know if it's that, but I'm just going to do my garrison stuff, and then I'm going to go fuck around in Dota.
Sometimes I wonder how much of our concern for something like ISIS is flared up by the media, because there's no doubt they're a threat. But when you say we've never seen something on this scale, ISIS is also has not crashed two planes into the Twin Towers.
That is true.
They have also not bombed a U.S. embassy. While they're a threat in their world, to me, I would argue they're not a global threat. Their threat has not really, they have not really outwardly straight up attacked. Now, they may have hacked people, like has been purported, but...
Well, the way that they recruit in social media, actually here in Virginia, in Prince William County, one county north of where I went to high school in Stafford County, the FBI just arrested someone who was a 17-year-old high school student who was recruited by ISIS over social media. So that they are being able to infiltrate the youth of other countries, that's what makes it very concerning to me, is that you have a rogue organization that is recruiting in the most modern way. And the way that they advertise to the youth is scary. Just to take a pause on this really, really quick, something big is going down right now. The Saints and the Seahawks are trying to finalize a trade for Jimmy Graham and a fourth rounder for Max Unger and Seattle's first round pick.
Interesting.
You know, I've seen some polling that says that, you know, anywhere between 55 and 60% of Americans wants to see U.S. boots on the ground to start a ground war with ISIS. You can't do that.
No, you can't. We're not. We've proven that we can't. We're not very good at fighting that war. That kind of war, because it's not, and that's what I mean is, I don't really see the world ever getting to a point where,
you want some cereal?
I don't see the world getting to a point where we're willing to go to war, like how even we did in Desert Storm. It's becoming just too, because the problem is the world's become more expensive. More and more of us are becoming less interested in war. And we're less interested in our governments messing around with other countries.
Yeah, we don't have a very good track record when it comes to that, let's be honest.
Well, it's not just that. We are globalizing. in a way not seen before. Me and you talk about that a lot. But I think what we're seeing is yes, we're globalizing. And yes, that's true. But we don't need the government to help us globalize.
The internet's been doing that for
us. Yes, we can do that on our own. But what we do need is keeping our shit straight here at home. That's something the government could be doing for us. And I think that is more of us going, you know, we've been focused for 15 years so much on a part of the world that the only way it affects us is because we are at war with them. And when I say that, I mean it affects us as in we, our loved ones are the ones going and dying and fighting over there. And I just think people are just, I think we're just exhausted of it. And I think that means we don't think as much of veterans because, you know, we, when people talk about we took care of our veterans, yeah, we did after World War II, but we didn't after Vietnam. We didn't really after Korea. We did after Desert Storm, but we didn't after these wars. And the kind of the themes in all of those is the ones that we support are the wars that we were wholeheartedly for. The wars that we weren't wholeheartedly for were not as supportive of our troops when we come home, when they come home. And I think especially this time around, because there are a lot of people that go, we respect that we have soldiers that have to go fight for us. But then there are also people that say, yeah, that's true. But at the same time, the difference between a soldier that went to Iraq or Afghanistan now and someone that went to World War II or Vietnam is you were drafted in World War II and Vietnam. Now, if you join the military in 2000, 2001, 2002, this isn't true, but if you join the military 2005, 2006 and after, like, you knew you were going to be sent to war. And then you come home, and then you...
In my mind, that almost demands, in my mind, that since they were so selfless to make that sacrifice, they deserve, and they should be demanding our respect.
But one would argue, what of ours are they protecting over there? Like, the thing from the Middle East, the person from the Middle East that affected me as an American, he's dead. We got him. That's why we went over there. That's why I said we should go over there, get the motherfucker that affected me. But beyond that, when you say that, and you're signing up to go to the military, and you want to defend our freedoms, what of our freedoms are you defending over there? Really?
Now, that's a truthfully delicate point there.
I mean, it's not an unpopular thing to say or think about, but it is some degree true. And I'm not saying we don't need a military, and I respect our armed forces, but at the same time, the reason a lot of people, and you can debate the merits of this, of course, the reason a lot of people went to the military is because it was an easy way to get a pretty good paying job that would teach you some skills. And I'm about to play the devil's advocate, unpopular free market guy. You are given a really great set of skills from the military. Why can't you come back and be a productive member of society? Why do you need us to help get you a job? In theory, you should be better qualified for most jobs. I mean, if you're in the military, you've worked on, you have to fix your truck in the middle of a battle. You've done mechanics. You know, you're good with tools. You're good at leadership skills. Like, you have a lot of skill sets. And there are a lot of veterans that come home and excel in those areas. And so to some degree, it's how come some veterans can come back? Now, the ones that come back and have actual like PTSD and stuff, I mean, those need our help. But on the whole, if you're just a veteran and you're just come back from war because you're done, your stint in the military is done, and you don't want to go back in, use your skill sets that have been given you to go pursue employment. Because I tell you what, if me and you were applying against a job, and then somebody that had served the past 8 years in the military came in and applied for the job, more than likely, we're not getting that job.
Actually, that's partially true, but it's more untrue than you think. When I was a manager, and we hired people, that is something that we personally looked for, because as a business, we realize that, you know, our former members of the military have the most to offer because they've been, it's the way that they've been taught to see the world, how to view respect, how to view people, that yada yada yada. But a lot of people, a lot of businesses in this country are worried about bringing our former veterans on because, you know, they may suffer from PTSD or stuff like that. And that choice, look, I understand that it is a business's choice to hire whom or whom they don't, but more businesses do need to be more open to hiring them.
Now, just as a counter to them, you have someone like Chris Kyle. That discussion was about the mentality of soldiers.
When I'm an employer, would it affect my decision to hire you if I know that you signed up to go to war in a war that by the time you signed up, we all knew we shouldn't have been there, or even more so, you signed up after Bin Laden was dead? And it's like you're signing up knowing as soon as you're ready, they're going to send you to war. You know this, and you know where we shouldn't be there anymore. In fact, more than likely, unless you're from a military family, your family is probably against you joining the military to go to the war that they don't think we should be in anyway. So you choose to go do something where you know you're going to go jump into fighting to kill people. And I understand the brotherhood argument, but to me, that only applies once you're in it. If I'm just an 18-year-old kid, nobody in my family's been in the military, it's not the military brotherhood that is, now that might be attractive to me, but I'm not saying I'm going to go over there to fight for my brothers. No, you don't know what that means yet.
Well, both of my cousins joined the military around that age. A lot of my friends who I went to in high school up in Northern Virginia did the same thing. And I can, now not being someone who has ever served, I will tell you from those that I have met and who are very good friends with, from the first day that you're there, they are your brothers, no matter what. It's
But the key words you said there were from the day you get there. And then when you're signing up, you haven't experienced that yet. That might be what you want, but as I said, it's one of those things where...
Oh, you're saying like when you're at the recruitment office and Uncle Sam is giving you its pitch.
Or what makes you walk into the recruitment office? As an employer, I may question the motives, because you could say, oh, I just went in to pay for school. Well, there are other ways you could have paid for school. There were other paths that didn't involve going to war.
Now, at the time when a lot of these people, a lot of our current military joined, there wasn't a lot of other options out there.
Since will you repeat what you said? Sorry, my headphones crackled.
I said you have to think about also too, at least for this arc, for this discussion, the time of when they joined. There wasn't a lot of openings. Like, let's say someone wanted to have a way to pay for school that wasn't gonna, you know, bring them down monetarily for the next 20 years, having to pay off debts. I mean, it's a very valiant trade-off to trade your service for defending your country for an education.
Yeah, but with federal loans, like I said, the education thing you can do without going to war. And yeah, you could say you could do that sacrifice, but let's say I'm not willing to make that sacrifice and there's no job opportunities during the time and I go sell weed. And I get arrested. Because I chose not to go fight in a war, I'm going to go to jail because I was doing what it took to make ends meet at the time.
Couple pieces of breaking news here really fast. Haloti Ngata will be traded to the Lions, and the Rams are close to finishing a trade with the Philadelphia Eagles to send Sam Bradford to Philly for Nick Foles and a draft pick.
Wow.
The Jimmy Graham trade is complete. It is finalized.
Wow. Sam Bradford, Chip Kelly. Bold move. All right, it's almost 4. We're switching back to NFL talk. What do you think about that, Sean Brown?
Well, let me... which one do you want to talk about first?
Sam Bradford.
I just hope he can...
What does it specify, what draft pick? Because I feel like that's important.
No, Schefter doesn't have the...
draft pick, yep.
The draft pick yet, no. You know, I think, honestly, I think a change of scenery will be wonderful for Sam Bradford. I liked him coming out of college. He's got a good arm. He's fairly accurate. I just hope he can stay healthy.
Not tear his ACL again. Yeah, I mean, he's one where he has the natural talents and tools he needs. It's just a matter of he's so fragile. He's now had 3 major injuries in his career, dating back to college. Now, the reason I say the draft pick is important is if it's like a 5th-round draft pick, I think it's worth the gamble. I think Bradford has enough upside that if he stays healthy, he can win you some ball games. But if you had to give like a 2nd or 3rd rounder, then I think it's expensive because honestly, I don't think much of Nick Foles.
No, I didn't even think much of him out of college either. I mean, he's kind of like a Kyle Orton or something like that. You know, serviceable, but it isn't going to do that much for you. I think his hot start is a direct correlation to what Chip Kelly runs. Very easy quarterback system.
So that's an interesting move.
And Jimmy Graham getting traded to Seattle is just huge.
Do you think that means that they're not going to make a move for Mariota?
I would say no, but I don't know if the Eagles. Here's what I think: if they're still going to go for Mariota, now they have a lot of ammunition to move from the 20th pick to the second pick. If they're going to go for Mariota, now I think they have something better in their hands, a la Sam Bradford, to trade to the Titans to make that losing their second pick not hurt so much. But ultimately, do I think they're going to go for him? I don't think so.
So you think Bradford potentially could be just a trading piece?
It wouldn't surprise me.
Yeah, because he has more value than a Nick Foles paired with a draft pick. Because they could go, we'll give you a first and Bradford. What do you think? First and Bradford for their first? Or first and second and Bradford for their first?
I'm not sure.
Because to me, it's just something where if I'm going for Mariota, I don't want to touch next year's draft pick. So it would have to be Bradford and first and third, something like that. Might be worth it to move up. I don't know if necessarily he's worth it to move up to, because I don't know if he could really go now. That makes me wonder if maybe their think is get Bradford in here. It's pretty cheap. That's what I mean. Like, it depends on that other draft pick. And then you drop down of, hey, Rams, we'll offer you a first and a second, or, one and two thirds, one, a first and three this year and a three next year to move up to your first to get Mariota to sit him behind Bradford, and then going, Bradford, we got pretty cheap. And if Bradford gets hurt, we got Mariota in the wings. Because I feel like at the same time with Bradford, they don't have Vic anymore. Do they?
Say that again?
They don't have Michael Vic anymore, do they?
No.
No, he's with the Jets. So with no Vic, with no Foles, who else does that leave other than Bradford?
The Sanchez.
Oh, shit, that's right.
Oh, here's some breaking news for the Bears. It looks like Antrell Roll will be coming to Chicago. Finally, a safety. Thank the good Lord. Please make it official. Oh, here's something big for you, CG. Owen Daniels, tight end to Denver.
Traded or signed?
Peter King didn't say, but it looks like it's just a sign. And Schefter is saying that right now the Jets are the favorite for Darrelle Revis. Yes, it's just a sign. Schefter just tweeted it. At the under 8 timeout, Virginia Tech in the ACC tournament is tied at 23. the Haloti Ngata trade was mid-round draft picks from the Lions to the Ravens. Super Bowl MVP from the Seahawks, Malcolm Smith, linebacker, is going to the Oakland Raiders. What's your, how do you feel about Chip Kelly?
I'm indifferent for him still.
I don't know what he's doing. Other than getting younger and faster. I mean, they let a lot of good talent walk.
Jimmy Graham to Seattle. Falcons. Texas. Texans linebacker Brooks Reed is expected to sign with Atlanta.
I think, yeah, that was their plan B. They were going after Malcolm Smith real hard. I mean, obviously, since Dan Quinn is their coach, obviously
and
he
Frank-
would want.
Frank Gore and Andre Johnson, former Miami teammates, scheduled to arrive in Indianapolis on Jim Irsay's plane early this evening.
Ooh.
Replace Reggie Wayne with Andre Johnson? That makes no sense. You would have gotten Reggie Wayne for cheaper.
Ah. Chris Mortensen just, brought up an interesting point, which will help kind of...
Oh, actual trade compensation and Brandon Marshall trade. Jets get Chicago's 7th-round pick plus Marshall for New York's 5th-round pick.
LOL. According to Mort, Sam Bradford is back with Eagles offensive coordinator Pat Shurmur, who was the Rams OC when he was drafted. Oh, wow. Yeah, I just saw that, what you just told me. That's wow. There it is from Pro Football Talk. Bears to sign Antrell Roll. All right, so now we'll have a safety and an outside
Greg
linebacker.
Greg Hardy is a free agent.
That doesn't surprise me, but it'll be interesting to see. Now he had all of his stuff dropped against him, right?
Yeah.
I wonder who'd like to take a risk on him. He's a good player.
Yeah, maybe this scared them straight, you would hope, as a team ownership. I don't know if I would take a risk on them, but...
Good Lord. the Jaguars are paying Julius Thomas an average of $9.2 million over 5 years, $24 million guaranteed. Money talks. Although I'd rather have the ball coming from Peyton Manning's hands than from Blake Bortles.
Wait, oh, the Julius Thomas is official?
Yes.
Mike Iupati's deal with Arizona, 5 years, $40 million plus incentives up to $41 million with 22.5 guaranteed.
I tell you what, it still hurts me that when Mark Trestman got hired, that the Bears didn't hire Bruce Arians, former Hokie. I tell you what, you get that team a quarterback, or if Carson Palmer can stay healthy, even with Todd Bowles leaving, and what's his name, Dick LeBeau, being over there in Arizona. Watch out, world. That could be a good team for the next 2-3 years.
Colts re-sign Mike Adams to a 2-year deal.
The Chicago media market's having fun with that last tweet from Schefter. David Haw of the Chicago Tribune just said, the Bears essentially said, take him, please. That being Brandon Marshall.
Sean Brown, look at the stream.
Hold on.
No. Hey, come here.
It froze on me at some point earlier. I had to reset it.
Can you see me now?
Yeah, I do.
It's Tim.
Timmy!
Doodle Cartoons.
Hello, Tim.
Okay, you can go be free now. You can go be free. I've let the interweb see your adorable ass.
DuPont is cuddled up over here on the couch, just taking a little kitty nap. No, look at his tail. No, he was looking over your shoulder when you went away.
Was he?
Yes, he was. Emeril Lagasse is very sad that Jimmy Graham is leaving. Poor Emeril. In not exciting news, Sean Hill signed with the Vikings, lulz. Here's a good zinger from Jim Rome. The only person in Philly excited about Sam Bradford's anticipated arrival is Mark Sanchez.
Former Bills tight end Lee Smith expected to join Oakland per sources, and Bengals tight end Jermaine Gresham expected to visit Oakland today.
The Redskins signed former Bears defensive tackle Stephen Paya for a 4-year contract, making more than $5 million a year. Underrated Bear, good player. Owen Daniels got 3 years.
With us?
Yes, sir. Nothing on the money side that I saw. Mike Adams staying with the Colts. Oh, Schefter just told me there is no deal in place for Antrell Roll.
I just saw that myself.
Here's my thing about Roll. I know we need safeties. I mean, we've needed safeties for about 10 years, and that's not a joke. The thing is he's what, 32,
33? Somewhere along there.
Kind of old for a safety, isn't it, these days?
I mean, I guess everybody's playing longer, but yeah.
Oh, yes. According to Aaron Lemming of the NFL, the Bears are close to a deal. Let's hope this is true, because I could be okay with this. For Eddie Royal.
Eddie Royal. There's also some rumors I read that that Broncos were interested in him.
I'd like to have a couple more former Hokies on my team, not named Josh Morgan.
Was this your fish shore? Why are you destroying it?
It'll be interesting to see later on. While we've been on, Hillary Clinton's been giving her her press conference about her emailing practices. Hokies on an 8-0 run. 36-29 over Wake Forest right now.
Pat's deciding not to pick up Darrell Revis's option. Of course, that doesn't necessarily mean, as you've said, that he won't be back with the Correct. Patriots, but what are his options?
Look, the Patriots have until 4 p.m. Eastern today to sign him to a new deal. And if they don't get him signed by that time, The floodgates are open and anyone can step in. And at that point, it shapes up as a two-team race between the New England Patriots and the New York Jets. Now, again, if the Patriots don't get him signed by 4 o'clock Eastern, that may be their best chance. And if he's not signed by then, their chances, you would think, go down because the Jets then would have the
winter has been come in so bad. I'm looking at a photo
that
here
New
that
England
there are
has made to Darrell Revis up until
icebergs.
This point. But the fact of the matter is, Darrell Revis has a decision to make
washing up
this morning,
on
this
Cape
afternoon,
Cod.
Tonight, whenever he's made it, maybe he's already made it. And that is, does he go to the New England Patriots? Or does he take more money, because the Jets will be offering more money,
right,
to go back to New York in what will be the last big contract of a career full of big contracts?
And you wonder if winning a Super Bowl finally is going to impact that decision one way or another.
The Eddie Royal rumor is gaining some more legs.
Alrighty, his free agency is in its mid-flurry. We've been on the air for about 2 hours, so I think we're going to bring today's episode to a close. We want to thank our viewers for tuning in. We hit a peak of three.
Excellent.
Look, we've had 160 total views. Since
nice.
We began airing on Saturday night. We also have 9 followers.
So what, that's 40 views a day?
Not bad.
Not bad at all.
And we haven't had our big show tonight, which will be coming on around 8 p.m. tonight. We won't be going as late because somebody's got work the next 2 days. Although I would love to be able to just stream, still pretty go late, but maybe I'll stream from work tomorrow, do a little Wendy's behind the scenes.
Excellent.
Although I'd love to stay on. Oh man, I'd rather do this. That's why audience start like just paying me a lot of money and I'll do this for you 24 hours a day. But Sean Brown, thanks for being my you're not really a guest of the show on this particular podcast. You are my co-host on this particular podcast. We're coming up with some ideas. Maybe I'll put it up on our Facebook page at some point this week, trying to maybe get a title for our podcast here. Over the ensuing days, it'll slow down the next couple of days because I'll be working, but I'm going to try to get them up as fast as possible. I got about 2 more Dota videos to post, maybe 2 WoW videos, and I want to get today's episode up on the YouTube as well this week. So to get our viewers plenty of content to go, we are in a search for a title of the show. So if you're a viewer and you have some ideas, please pass them along. Tweet us on Twitter, will_t_gaming. You can drop it on our Facebook page at facebook.com/WilliamTellGaming or visit us on our webpage at www.WilliamTellGaming.com. Sean Brown, it's been a pleasure, and I've enjoyed it here this afternoon.
As have I, boss. Thank you very much.
I hope to see you this evening.
I'll be here.
Well, like I said, viewers, we'll be on about 8 p.m. Tonight. We'll be using more of the webcam tonight. Messing around with that more as times go. I want to maybe get a green screen, put me on Mars with Curiosity Rover, do an interview with the Curiosity Rover. I'll figure it out there. I'll figure out how to do these damn things.
But you're
going to
give an interview with a robot?
He's a rover, right? He's not a robot. I guess he's a robot. But yeah, talk to me. He's going to beep, boop, boop at me. We're going to be doing this. The next episode of this particular podcast, we're talking from everything from politics to tech to sports. Today was dominated a lot by sports, some nice, interesting politics, but definitely dominated by sports. But it's the first day of free agency. What can you expect? But here on this podcast, simply right now, talking nerdy about all things politics, sports, tech, comic books, movies, TV, everything pop culture. The next episode,
if it's interesting, we talk about it.
So the next episode of this podcast will be airing around the same time, around 2:00. We're going to try to start at a more definitive time, but we're getting things up and going here, so we're going to be a little more consistent moving forward, hopefully. But Friday around 2 p.m. will be the next episode of this one. We will have an update on that research question we had for researching the Trent Richardson situation with the Indianapolis Colts. And maybe if we find anything with meat, we'll post that up on the website as well. It'll be our first bit of independent reporting.
Oh, very, very quickly, Jake Locker is retiring.
Wow.
So maybe what I said about Sam Bradford and the trade to the Tennessee Titans might have some legs.
Well, if it's true, we will have proof. You said it here first on William Tell TV.
Watch out, Adam Schefter. I'm coming for you, baby.
So Friday we'll have the results of me and Sean Brown's investigative reporting as we come back and talk a little nerdy on Friday afternoon at 2 p.m. I want to thank all of our viewers for tuning in. Just one more time, follow us on Twitter, like us on Facebook, and check us out at WilliamTellGaming.com. It's been wonderful to see you guys this afternoon, and tune in later tonight around 8 p.m. for some World of Warcraft, Warlords of Draenor, and Dota 2 action, and of course, generally just also a continuation of Talking Nerdy on William Tell TV.